A very good afternoon. Welcome to MIDCAP Radar. I'm Nigel D'Souza, and with me is Sumaira Abadi. Hey, Sumaira. It's looking good. We're virtually through a majority of the trading session. It's a Monday, and we have started off very, very well. 10,000 on the index. The broader markets as well looking quite good. And that's the start today. IndusInd Bank. One would have wondered what reaction we would see. Well, the verdict's out. 5.5% returns in today's trading session.
Yeah, and you know, for a stock which has such little weightage in the Nifty, today it's topping the charts, really, so to say, in terms of contribution. And even the Nifty Bank has inched higher, so now sitting with a gain of about 1.25%. But let's get started. These are our top stories. It's a strong start to the trading week as the frontline indices edge up over 0.5% apiece. Mid-cap index outperforms while banks lead the charge. Advances the bank Nifty over 1.25%.
And IndusInd Bank hits a fresh 52-week high as CNBC TV18's news break is confirmed. The bank enters into exclusivity talks with Bharat Financial. Romesh Sobti tells CNBC TV18 and says that the deal will be margin as well as EPS accretive from day one, while Mr. Rao of Bharat Financial says that the deal will be complete post due diligence.
Tata Motors, Maruti and M&M gain on lower than expected cess hike on mid-sized cars, large cars and sports utility vehicles by the GST Council. Gen irrigation surges after the council decides to lower rates on irrigation equipment.
And gas stocks are in focus after India renegotiates the LNG pricing formula from Australia's Gorgon project to make the fuel affordable to domestic customers. The new price is 13.9% off the prevailing oil price at the port of delivery.
And oil prices gain as the Saudi oil minister discusses possible extension of a pact to cut global oil supplies beyond March 2018. Metals, though, are under pressure on the Shanghai Exchange on flat import data from China. Indian metal stocks, however, continue to outperform and trade.
All right, then IndusInd Bank has hit a fresh 52-week high. CNBC TV18's news break is confirmed. The bank enters into exclusivity talks with Bharat Financial. Mr. Sobti of IndusInd Bank and Mr. Rao of Bharat Financial spoke exclusively to CNBC TV18. Let's hear out what they had to say.
What our sources are telling us is that it's an exclusivity period for 30 days. Could you confirm to that as well, sir?
Yeah, you see, it's not going to take less than that period. I think the margins, that's very accretive on day one. And secondly, as you know, in the terms of risk weightages, therefore capital usage in the hands of the bank, the same portfolio is 75%, whereas in the microfinance institution, it is 100%. I think that's also a big boost to there. Then, of course, the branch network and the entire portfolio becomes priority sector, which means that I think we are already surplus priority sector. We can sell this priority sector through the certificate, which is a very good market, which is emerging. Then I think the client base is ripe for, first of all, savings products.
No, this is kind of an engagement. So the due diligence has to be done on both sides. And we have to negotiate the final terms, post which we can say that the deal is a done deal.
Okay, then, so that's those two definitely are the stocks of the day, Bharat Financial as well as IndusInd Bank. But just keep your eye out on the screen. You know, we have a couple of stocks that are moving around. Jubilant Foodworks, take a look at that stock. It's lunchtime, maybe it's pizza time as well. Jubilant Foodworks spikes up as we speak. Balkrishna Industries as well, after the big run that we've seen in the last couple of years, that continues. So that stock as well is higher. And Granules India, that's the other one I'm looking at. That stock as well doing quite well. But however, everything's not going great guns because JP Associates, the one that really surprised us in the last couple of months, it had a very, very good July. Then, in fact, it had a weak August. That stock has fallen off. You know, we had that court ruling that did come in, pulling up the promoters as well. So that stock is down close to around 8.5%. And that entire fall has happened just in
the
last
week. Actually, you know, there was news that came in that the Supreme Court had directed JP Associates, the parent of JP Infra, to deposit 2,000 crores, and they have restrained the MD and CEO from leaving the country. All proceedings against JP Infra, of course, have been stayed until further orders. Mm-hmm. And the IRP will be submitting the interim resolution plan within 45 days. So this news sort of came about, I think, 10, 15 minutes back.
Okay, all right. There's plenty of stocks, though, that are moving around. So let's pull in Ronit. He's standing by. He's going to tell us some interesting movers that we're seeing in today's trading session. Ronit, over to you.
Yes, so one of the stocks that are buzzing today is Kamath Hotels. Remember, they reported their results on Friday. See, their revenue was flat, but their PAT came at around 13 crores versus a loss of 1.4 crores. So why this such a jump in their PAT? Largely due to a reduction in their finance cost. Their finance cost came in at 2 crores versus 9 crores. Why? So the company recently did a one-time settlement with Canara Bank. So they have a loan of around 678 crores with Canara Bank, and we'll have to see that, you know, how much this loan reduces by going ahead. And they have a long-term debt of around 335 crores versus their market cap of 241 crores. So this stock is up around 15-16%. Next is Federal Mogul. They also reported their results on Friday. The revenue was again flat, but the EBITDA was up 20% and their margins expanded by 200 bips. So, you know, this stock has been in the news lately because of the shift from BS4 to BS6, where they'll be one of the biggest beneficiaries going ahead. Back to you.
All right, Ronit, thanks very much for that. Also in focus are a lot of these gas stocks, particularly Gale and Petronet, on the renegotiation of LNG pricing formula from Australia's Gorgon project. Varinder is here with the details. Hi, Varinder. What will be the impact on these stocks?
Gas is a raw material for Petronet LNG, and the pricing after that renegotiation, you know, and hence, you know, you are seeing the stock moving up. And the off-takers for you know, gas are companies like Gale, BPCL, IOC. Gale is important because it's not only the, you know, the cost moving down, but also the demand push which Coat is expecting, and that is why the stock is moving up. So I'll tell you what has happened. Importantly, there's a renegotiation of LNG pricing formula from Australia's Gorgon project. If you remember, in 2015, there was Qatar's RasGas where the renegotiation happened, and that was at nearly half the price of the earlier contracted price. Now, what has happened this time with this Gorgon project? The new pricing formula is nearly 13.9% of the prevailing oil price at the port of delivery. In a simple term, it means that if crude is at $50 per barrel, the pricing comes 6.95 per unit. Earlier, this same pricing on the, you know, stipulated formula was nearly 8.25 per unit. So in a simple manner, the pricing comes down from 8.25 to 6.95, and hence, you know, companies like Petronet LNG are benefiting. Petronet, of course, has the highest, you know, volume in terms of the import coming in from there. The last time I remember, it was nearly 1.5 million ton per annum, which was signed in August 2009, and hence the company benefits. Some of the numbers which are floating around say that this could be a saving of nearly 10,000 crore for India because of this renegotiation. Kotak, in one of the notes, says that it is very good for Gale because not only the price cut, but also the demand push will help Gale. Also, about Petronet LNG, it's a feather in the cap. The stock trading around reasonable valuation with high growth expectation from the gas sector as a whole is moving up. So watch out for both these companies. Even the oil minister tweeted the same on this renegotiation during the weekend, which is what is adding fuel to all this, you know, stock moving up.
All right, Varinder, thanks very much for those details. And on a quick programming note, India's leading business awards are back. We bring to you the 13th edition of the India Business Leader Awards, where we reward the best of the best each year. The eminent jury meets this afternoon, and what's more special this year is that a jury consists of the most powerful women business leaders of the country. In fact, it's the first all-women jury. So stay tuned to CNBC TV18 in just a short while from now. Arundhati Bhattacharya, Naina Lal Kidwai, Chanda Kochar, Shikha Sharma, Kaku Nakate, Manisha Girotra, Shobna Kamineni, and Nisaba Godrej will deliberate and decide on the winners for this year.
Okay, then, let's slip into a short break. But on the other side, we'll have our first management with us. We'll get chatting with management of Gujarat Alkalis. Remember, this is on the back of the sharp spike we've seen. Focus on the JP Group stock. Some of them have taken a hard knock. Remember, this is after the Supreme Court has modified its earlier order in the JP Infratech case. Ashmit has been tracking that very, very closely over the past half hour, Rod. Ashmit, tell us what's going on there. These stocks have seen a sharp decline just in the last 15 to around 20 minutes.
Well, the Apex Court is not mincing words now. The Apex Court, just to remind our viewers, the last time had stayed the NCLT order, which had instituted the insolvency proceedings in the first place. And by doing so, What effectively the Apex Court had done is that it had put the JP management back on track, back in control as far as these companies are concerned. Today, the Attorney General led the charge, pointed out that that was not the result that the Apex Court would have wanted. That is not the result that the home buyers or the lenders want. And that in pursuance of that, after wide-ranging arguments, the Apex Court has given various directions. The first, the chief amongst them being, of course, that the IRP will now be back in control. The management will be out. The IRP is back in. The IRP will have to come out with a resolution process. But that is just the first direction. The second direction, equally scathing, that in the interim, JP Associates will have to furnish a sum of 2,000 crore rupees.
Okay, all right. Ashmit, thanks so much for joining in and making sense of what's going on there on that front. Well, but the Nifty, it's holding above that 10,000 odd mark. So let's get chatting. We have Ashwini Gujral who joins us. Ashwini, you'll be tracking the Nifty, I guess, on the closing basis as well. Any kind of levels you're looking at in terms of a closing? And also, what's the trade now on the Nifty?
See, basically, if we are able to close above 9980,
yeah,
that should qualify as a breakout, given that the banks are leading it. I think Yes Bank, IndusInd Bank should have more on the upside. I would have liked SBI and ICICI to participate, but that hasn't happened. Maybe they'll participate from tomorrow onwards. Mm. But the market now clearly has a theme which it can run after, which is this, you know, MFI deal space, which would keep the banks warm.
Okay, we'll try and reconnect that link with Ashwini in just a bit. But let's just take a quick check on the market as well, because it looks like there's a fresh up move that is underway. Mm-hmm. The mid-cap index now up about 1%. The Sen underway. Mm-hmm. The mid-cap index now up about 1%. The Sensex has added about 200 points as of as we speak. And some mm-hmm. of the stocks actually seeing quite a bit of big moves. IndusInd Bank now almost 6% higher. GAIL is up 4%, so that's shaved off just a tad. Even something like a Tata Power, Nigel, today up about 4-odd%.
Absolutely, Sumedha. And let's get chatting with another, you know, a company that's, you know, has seen a good run. The stock, in fact, let's pull up Gujarat Alkalis. In the last 10, 15 days, it's seen a good run. That's on the back of the sharp spike that we have seen in caustic soda. You know, to understand what's going on there, we have with us, you know, the management who's joining in. Mr. Gera, the MD of Gujarat Alkalis, joins us. Hi, Mr. Gera. Thanks so much, sir, for joining in. Very quickly, sir, we wanted to understand what's the price movement in terms of caustic soda. What was the average price in the last quarter? That's quarter one. And what is the average price today?
Well, the price is not single for everyone. I mean, it varies from customer to customer. It is an average price we can talk about.
Yeah.
It is now around 34 to 35, depending upon what you can pick up.
Okay.
So there are deals which are also taking at 32 even. But it all depends on customer to customer, how long run is and how short is the price and what is the quantum and everything. You know, price is not uniform. You can't say that it's same for everything.
Okay. So how much was it in Q1? And, you know, what is the reason exactly for this sharp move that we've seen in the prices?
International demand, the international demand, which is making it move around this place. You see, the quality, the issue, you know very well, the environmental issues in China.
Correct.
Have been taken, I mean, there the production has gone down.
Correct.
And they are requiring a higher amount from outside, you know, which was these are the some of the issues.
Okay.
Internationally, how the demand supply goes around.
Mr. Gera, we again are asking you, in your quarter one, what was the average price? If it's 34,000, 35,000 on an average today, in quarter one, what was the average?
Quarter one, it was around 32.
So it's only around 8% movement approximately. Okay,
yeah,
7 to 8% movement is what we've seen on caustic soda. Sir, if you could tell us, out of your total revenue basket, how much comes in from caustic soda?
About 53%.
Okay.
Yeah.
And okay.
Okay. So would there be any impact on margins because of this price move, and how much?
Yeah, but margins, yes, there is definitely improvement in caustic, but chlorine is playing also. Price where we have to pay sometimes, you know. Chlorine disposal is inevitable.
Okay.
The caustic is produced.
Okay, so
net is not easy. So, you know, chlorine caustic balance is there.
But net-net, sir, there'll be some margin expansion because of the price movement. Net-net, there'll be
there
some.
There is about, you can say about 5%.
Okay. And also, if you could tell us, what is your current capacity utilization levels in your caustic soda division?
83 to 84.
If others are shutting down, sir, you think you can take that from around 83, 84 to around 95, 96%? That will automatically help your top line growth. Is that possible?
No, it all depends upon the chlorine consumption.
Okay, the chlorine.
Yes, please understand that. That's a limiting factor for all of us. Because in India, chlorine supply is more. The EDC manufacturers are not there who can take this chlorine.
Right.
You know, India is a net importer of EDC. A huge opportunities there for someone to take a call.
Okay.
So that's it.
Okay, Mr. Guerra, one final question before we can let you go, sir. Last year you did, I think, on the top line, 2,300 crores revenues?
Yeah, inclusive of excise.
Inclusive excise. Yeah, gross revenue was 2,300 crores. This year, what kind of a revenue growth, sir, we're looking at? And what kind of a margin number can we look at for FY18? Your stock has seen a big run, sir, so there's a lot of excitement as it is.
Yeah, I mean, we are delighted that the shareholders are getting good value for their money, invested with us. And, if you are asking total,
top line,
we are thinking of about 2,400 to 2,500 crores, somewhere there.
So single-digit growth is what we're looking at?
Yeah. We don't expect very miraculous things here.
Okay, and margins will be stable at around this, 25%?
No, 25 is very high, I suppose.
21%?
I would not like to bet on that even. Let's leave it at that.
All right, Mr. Guerra. Thanks so much, sir, for joining in, giving us all those details. So the stock has seen a big run. What Mr. Guerra tells us is that, in fact, the average prices of caustic soda in the first quarter was at around 32,000. Now, in fact, it's moved to roughly around 35,000. But he's saying net-net, there'll be some kind of margin gain, but we'll have to watch out for sustainability of these prices as well. We had spoken to alumina producer, that's Nalco, and they told us that prices have really gone through the roof. So just keep that in mind. The stock has come off because the management sounds more or less cautiously optimistic. On that note, then, let's do one thing.
Our radar now is Rama Steel Tubes. The stock is up about 4.5%. They've reported numbers just a short while back. And Richie Bansal, the CEO, now joins in with the details of their Q1. Hi, Richie. Good afternoon to you. To begin with, can you tell us what has led to this big growth that you've seen on the bottom line? Was there any exceptional, and what is it on account of?
Yeah, hi. You know, like last year we installed this solar power plant in our Khopoli unit, which has straight away given us a growth in EBITDA margin of 0.5 to 0.7%. And secondly, we had like consolidated like almost 10 to 15% of exports in first quarter.
Richie, allow me to interrupt you for just a moment. Those are live visuals coming to you from the jury round of the India Business Leader Awards that are being held in Mumbai. They're just getting started. You can see the jury members walking in. That was Nenalal Kidwai, who has just entered. And as has been the tradition with the India Business Leader Awards, we award and reward the best of India Inc. every year. And we have the all-women jury this year around. So a proud moment for the CNBC TV18 team.
Okay, all right. Then we'll get back as and when we get some commentary coming in from there. But we are talking to Mr. Richie Bansal. Mr. Bansal, you know, just wanted to get a couple of numbers coming in from you. You said that there was some exceptional gain that you saw in the past a quarter. Did we get that right? And also, if you could tell us, last time you joined us, you said you're expecting to do a 25 to 30% growth on the top line. In this quarter, it's only around 7%. You're expecting the remaining 9 months to be very good?
See, our next 9 months are going to be like pretty good. Even our Q2 is going like pretty good in terms of our top line and bottom line both.
So, but 30% top line growth we'll see?
Yeah, for sure.
Okay. What's your order book like?
At the moment, we have an order book of next 2.5 months. Mm.
And what's the absolute number?
Sorry?
The absolute number? In terms of orders?
Approximately 50 crores.
Okay, so the order visibility actually, Richie, is not very great. I mean, only 50 crores. Are you confident that you're going to see more and more orders coming in there? And if you could give us a quick breakup, how much of your revenue is coming from exports currently? And going ahead, you know, from your order book, are you expecting more orders coming in from your export market?
Yeah, we are expecting more orders from the export market. See, at the moment, our steel market is like steel prices are going up every day.
Hmm.
Every month, the steel prices are going up. So, we're not keeping much orders in hand.
Okay.
So, order book is not an issue. We can get export orders, like, we can get any time.
All right.
Steel market is, like, very strong at the moment.
Okay. So, you're saying that because the steel market is, is so vibrant and prices are moving higher, you don't want to buy the steel currently. You're waiting. You're hoping the prices cool off. And that's a raw material for you.
That's right. Yeah, that's right.
Okay. And also, I believe that you have some capacity expansions that were coming on stream. So, that's good news. But what about the funding requirements? Do you have the required funds? Are you going to be raising some money from the market? Is it going to be...
No. Yeah. We're raising funding requirement. Like, everything will be met from our internal accruals at the moment. And we are not looking forward for raising the funds. At the moment, we don't need it.
Okay. And margins you can maintain at 7.5%? Downside risk over there?
7.5% to 8%, yeah.
Okay, I think the street likes what you're saying, Richie. Thanks so much for joining in. So that's the management of Rama Steel Tubes. Well, the numbers were more or less flattish, but the commentary coming in from the management telling us that 30% growth is what they like to see. Order book as well is picking up. And also, they don't require any more debt going ahead. So let's see how things go. As we speak, stock higher with a gain of around 4.5%. But we'll wrap up on Midcap Radar. You stay with us.